The encounter between Our Lady of Guadalupe and Juan Diego happened about 10 years after the conquest, about 1531. The story goes that Juan Diego was waking up very early in the morning to go to catechism class, and as he's passing this little hill of Tepeyac, he hears music. And so he goes to see what the deal is, and as he goes up the hill, he encounters this beautiful woman dressed in light, I mean, just beautifully dazzling colors. And she introduces herself to him as the Virgin Mary, but then says that she is the mother of the God of great truth, the God of all people, the God of the creator of heaven and earth. And she goes on to use all the sacred names, the titles of God that Juan Diego is very familiar with from his own culture and his own religion. Essentially, she asks him to go to the Bishop of Mexico and that there be a temple built here where she could gather people together, where she could console them, where she could comfort them, where she could heal them, where she could be their mother. And as you know from history, this is a time of great pain for the people. This is a time of conquest where people have died in the war, in the pestilence. And so there's misunderstanding between the indigenous people and the Europeans. And so this is a time of chaos, and she wants to be there to help people, to bring people together. So he goes to the bishop, and the bishop doesn't believe him and says, you know, if you want something, if you're really talking to the lady from heaven, then tell her to give you a sign. And so he goes back and he encounters Our Lady again that same day. And he's very sad, and she says, what's wrong? What happened? And he says, well, he didn't believe me. Send someone else, he says, someone who speaks better than I do, someone who's more important. I'm nobody. I'm just like the lowest of the low. And she looks at Juan Diego, who is beaten down, because when people are oppressed, when they have been conquered, they don't think much of themselves. They are beaten down, and they see themselves the way the conqueror sees them, as nobodies, as nothing. But Our Lady calls him dignified Juan Diego, dignified Juan Diego. Go again, it's absolutely necessary that you go. But she tells him in a motherly way, but don't go now, go to sleep now, go in the morning. And so in the morning, Juan Diego wakes up and his intention is to go to the bishop once again, but his uncle's dying. And so he says, well, my obligation to my uncle, I have to go get him help. So he says, if I go this way, I'm going to meet up with that lady again. She's going to keep me, and I won't be able to get the help I need. So I'm going to go this way. Kind of that classic Jonah story. You know, we know what we're supposed to do, but for whatever reason, we're not going to do it. So as he goes the other direction, Our Lady encounters him. He says, where are you going? Where are you going? And he explains. He's a little ashamed. And she says, don't worry about your uncle. Go to the top of the hill, and there you'll find the sign that the bishop, that it'll take to convince the bishop. So he goes up there, and lo and behold, there's these beautiful flowers that are blooming at a time when they shouldn't be blooming, and in a place in this deserty environment where they shouldn't be blooming. And he picks them, and he brings them to Our Lady. And the beautiful story of Our Lady of Guadalupe says that she took the flowers and she arranged them in his tilma, which is this, we'd probably call it a poncho or this garment that he's wearing. And she arranges the flowers in his garment. She closes and says, take these to the bishop. So long story short, he goes to the bishop. He says, I have the sign that Our Lady wants you to have. He opens his tilma. And there, with the flowers that fall out of it, is the beautiful image of Our Lady of Guadalupe that we see today, miraculously imprinted on this cloth made of cactus fibers that should only survive about 15 years. And now this image is just as vibrant as it was at that moment over 500 years later. I think that's part of the power of the story is that, first of all, it follows the same pattern that scripture we hear in Scripture. So whenever God wants to do something, God seems to choose the most unlikely people. And so so it is with Juan Diego. So, you know, Our Lady could have chosen to speak directly to the Archbishop. Why should she? You know, she's the Mother of God, you know. But she finds a person who has perhaps been overlooked by society as anyone of any importance, but has a good heart, has an open heart. God doesn't call people who are necessarily the most likely or most qualified, but rather the people who are most open to follow or to do something that they're asked to do. And so it was the case with Juan Diego. He was among the people that were looked down on. He was part of the indigenous people who were conquered. But also, you know, there were many, many mestizo children by this time, 10 years after the conquest, through the intermarriage of the Spanish and the Indians. And these children, because they were the children not born in marriages, outside of marriage, they were looked down on as nobodies, as the refuse of society, and they had no place in the world. Well, here comes Mary, as the first evangelizer, to bring good news, the good news that God loves you, and God wants you to know that God is with you. I'm with you. I want to be with you. And she comes speaking his language, number one. She comes dressed as one of them. Her face is a face of a mestizo woman, of a mixed blood woman. So she looks like one of them. And so when Juan Diego looked at Mary of Guadalupe, when we see her image, when the people of Mexico, when the people of Latin America see her image, they see a reflection of who we are. And so if she's my mother, I must be somebody. I must have some place in the society. I must have dignity. And so that's certainly part of the power of the story. To evangelize as she did and as she's called, so John Paul II, calls her the perfectly enculturated evangelization. What does that mean? Well, Mary comes speaking the language of the people. Her image, as it is now, encapsulates or incorporates all of the symbolism of the religion of the people. So Mary reminds us that when God sends us to evangelize, it's not the same thing as proselytizing or trying to hit people over the head with what we believe and what we, the way we do things, but rather to reflect back to them the beauty of their culture, the beauty of their religious beliefs, and to reflect back that God is already there, you know. And so as missionaries or as evangelizers, we are called to be like Mary, to have this deep respect for the people, to not assume that these people don't have faith, that these people aren't already in a deep relationship with God. But as Christians, as someone who, with Mary, of her image of bringing Christ to these people, we bring good news. We bring a new message of the love of Christ that goes beyond all divisions that we as human beings set up of who is in and who is out and what culture is good and what culture is not good. And Mary comes to remind us that God is found in every culture. God is found, and there's no perfect culture. So every culture has its beauty and its values and its lights, but it also, every culture has its limitations. But the good news is that God loves us in all our beauty and all our limitations. And so this example of Mary as the first evangelizer is a message for us, not just 500 years ago, but in our quest right now, in our call as church, to not just preach good news. You could talk about good news, but to be good news. Not just to go to church, but to be the church. You know, there's a big difference that Pope Francis in particular is reminding the church, this is nothing new, but is reminding us that actions speak much louder than words. And so Mary, in this encounter with Juan Diego, not only speaks to Juan Diego, but she embraces him, she encourages him, she walks with him, she gives him a tangible sign of her presence, of her, and this tangible sign is still with us today. You know, I'm Mexican-American, and my ancestors come from Mexico. And one of the things I say to other Mexican and Mexican-American people when I talk about Our Lady is, I have some good news and I have some bad news. The good news is Our Lady is our mother. Our Lady of Guadalupe is our mother, and she's with us, and she's always been with us throughout our history. Bad news is she's not just our mother. We don't have, she's a mother of all people. She came at a time before we even called this place America, before we even called this place Mexico. And she comes with a very specific message of bringing unity to the people of that land. And so she says to Juan Diego, I am your mother, and I am the mother of all the people from all the different cultures, races. And so she binds us together with the possibility of being one family. And this is the great message of Guadalupe that is often overlooked. Sometimes we see it more as a national kind of image, you know, oh, Our Lady of Guadalupe is for Mexico. Now, John Paul II, in his Ecclesia in America, his exhortation, says that Our Lady of Guadalupe is the mother of the continent. And she's the mother of us all. And she has a very important message of unity in our diversity. Because, as you know, the church is becoming more and more diverse, and not just in a kind of a general way. We go to church on Sunday, our parish looks different. There's people that we haven't met, people of other cultures, of other languages. And so her message of respect for difference, respect for diversity, of striving for what unites us, not just focusing on how we're different, but how can we be one church? How can we be one? And so this message of Guadalupe is very timely. It's something that we need to share with people. And that's why Guadalupe has such appeal, not just among Mexican people, but among Hispanics in general, but then also other immigrant groups like recent African immigrants, Filipino immigrants love Our Lady of Guadalupe, Vietnamese immigrants love Our Lady of Guadalupe. You know, so she is a symbol of a mother for all and a unity among all. You know, I had the wonderful opportunity of going to India not too long ago, and to speak about Our Lady of Guadalupe, among other topics. But many of the Indian people that I spoke with had never heard of Our Lady of Guadalupe. But when I showed them the image of Our Lady as a mestizo woman, a woman of mixed race, a woman of a darker complexion than we usually see the Virgin Mary, they loved her instantly. And they said, oh, we know that story here too. We too were conquered. We too have mixed blood communities. And skin color often determines a person's value. And now, as we see this image that you've brought us, you know, it's a beautiful image. We love Our Lady of Guadalupe. So she has that appeal with people. And she reflects back to people, especially people who are on the outside of society, people who are overlooked, people who are oppressed, people who are counted as nothing. She has a particular appeal and a power, I would call it. Of if she's my mother, I must be somebody. I must be somebody if she is my mother. And that's why Our Lady of Guadalupe has always been at the forefront of social change movements for justice. César Chávez, for example, always marched in his marches, in his action for justice for the farm workers, always had the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And this upset people. You know, this was a sign of contradiction, because the good news isn't always good news to people, especially when the message is that we need to share with people, or we need to include others that we haven't included. This isn't good news to people, and people will resist it. So Our Lady of Guadalupe is a sign of consolation, of comfort, but she's also a symbol that we need to work for change in our communities. We need to confront honestly some of those injustices that keep communities separated, that keep communities splintered, and rather, how do we find ways to bring people together? If you look at our story and our history as a people, so I'm talking particularly about Mexican-American people, but Latin American people from Latin America, Our Lady of Guadalupe represents a new birth for our people. So this was really the story of the birth of a people, the birth of a church. So when you talk about the feast of Our Lady of Guadalupe on December 12th, there are these wonderful celebrations. This is our Easter. I mean, this is the time when if you want to see who's in your community, that's when they all come to church. Because this is a time to recognize, and we may not know it here, why are we celebrating? But we know here, deep in our heart, this deep love for Mary, who represents not only the connection to God, because Mary, all Marian devotion, or all devotion to Mary, always should lead us closer to Jesus. So it's not so much a worship of Mary, but rather an honoring of Mary, a celebration of how she, as the first disciple, can lead us closer to a relationship with Christ. And so these wonderful celebrations that you refer to are always in dance. So in our culture, and in many other cultures, the only way to really celebrate, really pray, is to dance. And in the image herself, if you look carefully at the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe, she is in the process of a dance. The way her knees look in the image, the way her foot is coming from under her dress, we know that she is dancing. And the sacred truths of a people can only be communicated in dance. And so you'll see these beautiful indigenous dances at every church that honors Mary on December 12th. Some of the beautiful things about Marian devotion, or just devotion to Mary, or prayers to Mary, are bringing communities together to honor Mary, is that there's no rules or requirements for it. Everyone's welcome. You know, you don't have to, it's a very welcoming invitation to come and celebrate this woman who teaches us the way to God. And so she is a role model for us, and as Pope John Paul II said, the star of the new evangelization, star meaning that she guides us, because when it comes to Latino people, when it comes to Hispanic ministry, we are low-hanging fruit, you know. in other words, we have a very deeply Catholic culture that goes way back over 500 years, and it began with Our Lady of Guadalupe. So if we want to welcome Latino people, Mexican American or other Latino groups, have an image of Our Lady of Guadalupe in the church, in the parish rectory, not just because she's important to Hispanics, but because she's important to the whole church in America. As Pope John Paul II has said, she has something to teach us today. But just by having her image there will draw people. People feel welcomed. People feel that this is their place also. And that they can come and they can, get the help that they need. The beautiful icon of Our Lady of Guadalupe is rich with symbols and meaning. Obviously, the symbol of the sun that is behind Our Lady of Guadalupe is the most important symbol for the indigenous people of God's presence, the omnipresence of the sun. And so we have also the moon and the stars. So all these cosmic symbols were very important in the culture and the religion of the indigenous people. But also some of the more subtle symbols in her image is, one is that she's a pregnant woman. So this is one of the few images that we have of the Virgin Mary as a pregnant woman. We know she's pregnant because she's wearing this black sash around her waist, which is a symbol for the indigenous people of life. And so this woman has life in her womb. Right under that sash, you'll notice, well, her beautiful dress is covered in flowers, but there's one unique little flower right above her womb, right under that black sash, and it's four petals of a flower with a perfect circle. And this is a symbol of the fifth sun, meaning the people believed that this was the time that they were living in, when God would return to them, when all the prophecies that were foretold would be fulfilled. So Mary comes with her hands joined like this, which is a symbol for the indigenous people of offering, and she comes to offer her son to us. This is the good news. And this is something that the indigenous people could read from her image because it was written in the symbolic language that they knew. One mistake would be to think that the story of Our Lady of Guadalupe is something that happened in the past, something that wasn't that nice that that happened. And because Our Lady is very much with us today. So if you go to any community in our Mexican American or Latino communities, she's everywhere. She's on the buildings, in the murals, she's in our homes, she's in our yards, she's in our earrings, she's in our clothing, she's on our tattoos. In other words, for us, for Latino people, what Our Lady of Guadalupe is not something that's relegated to church or relegated to the past, but rather she gives us hope today. She gives us a sense of belonging today. And so the celebrations of Our Lady of Guadalupe on the 12th of December, but throughout the year, the devotion to Our Lady in our communities and her presence, the image of her presence throughout our material culture is a sign, is a symbol that Latino people are seeking God, that God is very much a part of our culture, a part of our life. And so this symbol of Our Lady of Guadalupe and devotion to her is very important in our efforts to evangelize today. Our Lady of Guadalupe, for example, as a mother, as a pregnant woman, is a symbol for us today of the dignity of human life. And so many communities use her image in their advocacy for life and to give women alternatives when they are pregnant that are really supported by the community. Our Lady of Guadalupe serves as a binding force among Hispanics, because oftentimes, you know, we think Hispanics are all from the same culture, but really Hispanics only exist in the U.S. You know, everywhere else we're Cuban and Puerto Rican and, you know, from all these different countries. But Our Lady of Guadalupe has the power to kind of bring us together as one family. But not just Latin Americans and Latinos, but the people of the U.S. who trace their roots back to Europe or the indigenous people of the U.S. also see in Mary of Guadalupe a symbol of God's love, a symbol, a binding force, a call for unity in our church. Many of our communities, our church communities, are divided. They may as well be three parishes, one for the Hispanics, one for the Vietnamese, one for the whites. And oftentimes these communities operate as separate. And the message of Guadalupe is Yes, how can we be together in our culture and celebrate our culture and celebrate Mass in our language? But how can we also come together as a larger family? And I think that Our Lady of Guadalupe can be a source of unity in these parishes that we have today, because we all love Our Lady. We all love her. We see Mary as a very important way to Christ, a way to live out our discipleship. So if you go to any neighborhood, you'll see her. And my hope is that if you go to any church, you'll see her. And I think that this is something that is a great hope for us today. Our Lady of Guadalupe is owned as a symbol, as an originating symbol, if you will, an overarching symbol that unites people from various experiences, various classes, various backgrounds. But the power of Our Lady of Guadalupe is oftentimes in that subconscious level. It's kind of how we might see a picture of our mother and feel, you know, love for our mother, or you know, this connection. And so when we see this image of Our Lady of Guadalupe, it has a force beyond words. But it also empowers people, as I've said before. It gives them a sense of belonging. It gives them a sense of their dignity. And so in every community, a Latino community, Mexican-American in particular, Mexican communities, you will have groups of people dedicated to Our Lady of Guadalupe, the Guadalupanas, the Guadalupanos. And these people are often the core leaders of that community. And they are people who are involved not only in the religious needs of the community, but some of their social needs, the basic needs that perhaps are not being addressed, the justice needs, the desire that people have and are treated with dignity.